I understand where you're coming from, but if somebody who is presently not doing well and listening to you right now, I don't think it is elaborate enough. So I will try and get into that mind space.
Yes.
So if we scratch the surface where you're saying you went to nature or you fell back upon yourself because there was no choice, I did not hear a sense of despondency or negativity in that answer. It didn't seem to me, oh, ab koi nahi hai, toh chal yaar, main hi sahi, aisa nahi laga. So there was a sense of positive vibe to your answer. So my question to you is, if you went to nature, one of the things I have realized often is, besides the comfort of being, even a walk on a good lawn does wonders for the mind. It just calms you down, says it's all right. Having read a lot of Zen earlier in my younger days, the grass survives what a tree doesn't, is because it learns to bend and stuff like that. It was very, very inspiring, because it says, anyways, grass hai yaar, iska kya aukaat hai, but wo rehta hai. And so I would want to ask you, what about nature? Was there an episode that happened at the hills? Was it just the ambience? Was it a chat? If you are willing to, go back to the memory and give us a glimpse of when did that compass change from despair to at least normal? Because I think normal is a plus point that none of us understand. I think after meditation, all of us understand, oh, being normal is a blessing. And you don't need to be ecstatic. You don't need to be sorrowful. You just are, is good enough. But I'm saying, when you are in that mind state, it doesn't strike you. You would rather wallow in pity for yourself or whatever. So what was that mind space? Would you be able to elaborate a bit?
Yeah. So like I said, right, I think the only tools I had were questions. So I had to ask some difficult questions to myself, which were very uncomfortable questions, to be very honest. It's easy to not ask sometimes these questions. So, I mean, I realized I opted out of placements, you know, and I sort of said that mujhe ye karna hai, I would like this exam. When I did not succeed, I came back home. When I came back home, I also realized my father was going through some stress. He actually had a cardiac arrest, and that's when it hit me. As an elder daughter, that's when it hit me that, hey, I'm responsible to help him out, you know, in many ways, in financial ways. So I come from a family of farmers. Essentially, my father's primary occupation is farming and a lot of other things. He's also a legal consultant. So I think he was juggling a few things. He was stressed. And that incident, I will not say shattered me. You know, I don't know. I mean, It did not shatter me, but it gave me a sense of responsibility early on, you know, at the age of 22, 23, that I need to step up and I need to figure a way out. But I have been an idealist, you know, there is some realism where you accept the reality. This is the reality. But then there is an idealist in you, especially in your early 20s, where you think of an ideal. And that idealism pushed me to find a job that's paying me decently well to take care of myself and my family, but at the same time, not compromising with what I want to do in life, which is, you know, very, very sort of unique and niche stuff at that point in public policy space, right? Now, no corporate or no set established organization was giving me that opportunity. So I ended up doing some here and there, some odd jobs, and then ended up finding some like-minded people with whom I started out. So it was running a social enterprise which we were creating. At the same time, I sort of made this condition that I want to draw a salary from day one, wherein I have to take this money home because this is my absolute need, right? So these conversations were not comfortable for a 23, 24-year-old to have with people who were sponsoring this, funding this. And also, I did not have enough work that I had done in the past to say that, like, to give them confidence that I will be able, right? The only thing I said that give me 3 months time. In 3 months, let's work together. And if if things work out well, then we will continue. If not, then not, right? Mm. And those 3 months, I did not take breaks. I did not do anything. And I think at the end of the 3 months, the people who were working with me realized that I did not take any day off. You know, I worked constantly for 90 days to get an event. There was an event I was working towards. And to make this event successful, I just did not stop, right? So being unstoppable in terms of having those, I mean, I realized I did not have a long vision to set for myself, right? Koi lamba, I did not know ki abhi to jo main soch rahi thi, this path is not working out. I have to now move to a different path. But I did not have clarity of that path. So I said, okay, let me just do something in smaller, like, let me just set some smaller goals. And working like that also helped me divert the attention from the negative thoughts that come, right? That there is a lot of negative thoughts, like you mentioned, that come in when you give space to those thoughts to come in. Okay. My approach was to actually absolutely not have enough space by making sure that I was working really hard around that time, where today I don't feel that, by the way, a lot of times. But back then, when I got to know of this concept only 3 years back when I read this book called Flow, F-L-O-W. And when I read this book called Flow, that's when I realized that, like, the Olympics champions that we are sort of talking about today, and these people, when they are focused on what they're doing, and they are in that flow state, which a lot of them meditators are in that flow state. And I did not know of all these terms, and I did not know of all these concepts. But when I read that book and I looked back at my life, those 3 months of time of after my failure, when I gave myself to do something, I now know I was in flow. And I was just, I did not have a goal for 5 years or 1 year. I did not even know where I will be after those 3 months. I had no job security. I just picked up something which I felt strongly about. Ki ye kar sakte hain. I just made sure it ticks boxes in terms of it's paying me, it's helping me pay my bills, it's helping me meet fun people at work. Finding that opportunity was also very tough, because I had to, like I said, I had to do cold calls, cold emails, go and meet people. This opportunity came up. Someone said, like, come meet me in Ghaziabad. I was somewhere in central Delhi. I sort of, you know, went the first time in my life, I went to sort of Ghaziabad on my own, you know, trying to sort of see how this opportunity could work out. It takes hustle. It takes, like, trying 20 things, getting 19 rejections, that one thing worked out, you know, and that also didn't work out like forever. I said that it's working out for 3 months. Let me do my best for these 3 months. After these 3 months, I will decide after that, right? That has been my strategy even today. I have no idea where I will be in a year's time, to be very honest to you. And this, people have started planning only short term because pandemic has hit and no one has long-term clarity in terms of a lot of the things that they plan. But I think I've always planned, like, my life broadly. You have a direction where you're going into one direction, but I have been open to possibilities. So I told myself that I will be open to these possibilities, and the connect with nature, I have no idea. I mean, I grew up in a small village. So maybe the first 5 years I spent in a small village in Maharashtra, and, like, we have some farms there, etc. So maybe that's a childhood connect, right? You feel a little bit more at ease or at peace in such situations, and you take the right decisions, I feel, when you are at peace. A lot of times, you know, in our city lives, which are very hectic, there's a stress, and I have felt that myself. There is, for example, there have been days where there's nothing stressing me out from a work standpoint. Life is okay, life is good, but still there's something heavy in my head, and I feel it when I meditate, right? But it's only when I go out somewhere in the nature and I feel like, okay, it's light now. It's lighter now. So I think there is something about nature that automatically helps me be at peace and hear my own thoughts without being cluttered by too many thoughts and too much noise. So I think being able to think, I mean, no one has clarity, but the only thing we can do is the thinning of that mind, right? Which could be through meditation, which could be through swimming, which could be through going for a walk in the park.
Yeah.
Where you are just, there are lesser thoughts, but, and that's when you hear and observe those thoughts and observe at the pattern and then you know what you feel strongly about. And if you are connecting yourself with that thought which you feel very strongly about, I feel people are able to sort of have some answers in front of them, some options in front of them. And maybe they might not work. Maybe, you know, I could have done that 3 month gig and I could have said, no, it's not working out, and I could have left. I did leave after 2 years. For 2 years, it worked out really well. After 2 years, I realized that, okay, this was enough. I mean, it was a great learning, but now it's not working out for me. It's time for me to move on. So I think it's just that constant effort and constantly trying things and different things out. And for people in 20s, I feel it's a golden opportunity to try multiple things.
Yeah.
I've realized this, that sometimes people used to tell me, but you only have 5 years experience. In my head, I used to say that I've worked like 3 shifts in those 5 years. I think I have 15 years of experience. So these are the things I could only say in my head. I could not say that out in interview. But that's how I feel that your effort multiplies, right? Because you've none of this, like in my early 20s, none of this felt like work also. Like I said, when I was in the flow state, did not felt like work. It felt like I could do these things very easily, and I was very driven. So I think somewhere it's my internal motivation guiding me, and somewhere it's that motivation also comes in different forms through different people you meet, different mentors you have, people who guide you. So it's a combination of all of these.
There's one aspect of your work that I wanted to know more about. See, when you speak, there is a lot of, although you did claim that you were not very clear what to do and you went through the dark night of the soul, as they call it very often. But it seems like once you knew a bit about where you wanted to go, you were quite foolhardy in everything that you did, and you refused to listen to anyone or anything and just went barging in. And I mean this positively. I don't mean it negatively, because
taken as a compliment.
Yeah. Most often, in a nascent field like yours, it's often only that works, because you don't have a structure that you can fall back upon. So I appreciate that part. I want to go to the other side, when one has to deal with somebody like a Supriya who doesn't listen to anything that you say. Was that a bother ever? Did that also bring in any aspect of vulnerability? Bunty was a friend for so long, but he doesn't understand in male, female, professional, personal. I don't mean anything specific, but just people who are around you suddenly see this completely new person.
Yeah.
यार कल तक तो ठीक थी, अब क्या हो गया इसको? और सुनती ही नहीं है यार. जो भी बोलो बोलती नहीं, अभी टाइम नहीं, अभी ये काम कर रही हूँ. So when you were going through this, and obviously you were processing your own grief in a certain manner by overworking, people who are watching this podcast, I do not support that kind of running away from the problem at all. But what I like was she moved from vulnerability to vulnerability time to time, again and again and again, without getting into a zone where she thought she had cracked it. I think that is worthy of emulating, if at all. So my question, to come back to that thought, did you feel a little vulnerable about losing out on the human touch with other people whom, because we are all human, we need that support. You did say that when you failed, you had to come back and you were looking for that. So
yeah.
Tell us a little about how you offended people and why you offended them. What was, because we all want that thing also that you're doing all right. So at that point, I think they are saying, no, you're not doing all right, you're mad. And you better listen to me.
I think this is a very good question. I think let me clarify something I said earlier, right? Which was about like working and how I was working.
Yeah.
I think different working styles work for different people. I like taking long breaks. Long breaks work for me. Every few years I take a mini sabbatical of sorts. You know, after 11 months, I sometimes take a 1 month break, you know, and in those 11 months, I'm working pretty much. So when I said that I work for those 3 months nonstop, I also went and took like 3 weeks break right after, right? So from a work balance standpoint, right? So I think that's something I wanted to clarify, because it does not mean that we burn out. It means actually, it means like for some people, like Monday to Friday system works well, and then Saturday to Sunday is a weekend, right? Like that's how we have designed. I personally feel it does not work for me. Like for me, like doing on weekends, I do different kind of work, but I still come back and like sit on my workplace and I do work, right? Does not mean I'm sort of being working and burning myself out, but I actually like doing the different kind of work that I do on weekends. And I'm actually planning to take a sabbatical next year for 3 months, right? So that 3 months I will be doing nothing but doing whatever I like doing, which is playing piano or reading or whatever. So that's just a clarification about working pattern. It's not to endorse it. It's not to endorse burning out, but it was just an example to give that how I set that goal. Yeah,
I wasn't being judgmental at all either. The idea was that impressionable people in a bad state of mind might just take this up in the wrong manner. And while have survived.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that is the most important thing to remember, especially in today's context.